The Avalanche. Tamarack. That's a native. It's a Native American name. It's been 1 month since we've been home from our trip to the North Cascades. For those of you unfamiliar with backcountry skiing, it's skiing without lift access. So where we go, it's a snowmobile in. So we take the sleds in between 4 miles and 12 miles. You can go further, but there's really no need. And you pick an aspect. You're basically driving into a mountain range that is a highway during the summer, but it's a slide path during the winter. And because of avalanches and the way in the steepness and the close proximity of each of these mountains, they can't physically keep cars safe during the winter, so they close it. And we take the sleds and we snowmobile out this beautifully scenic road. You pick a slope, you pick a mountain. Which one do you want to climb? Which aspect? North, west facing? Now, there are a lot of considerations when skiing in the backcountry, and the very first one is safety. Avalanches are something that occur often. They also can be cyclical. They can also be seasonal in nature. A few years ago, there was a early snowfall, and then it warmed up and it rained in the northwest. And so all of the base snow turned to ice, and then it froze. And on top of that, snow accumulated. And over the course of the winter, there was several feet, 10 feet of snow in places on a very unstable base. So imagine stacking something up on a sheet of ice, and then imagine that being a mountain and just turning that. That snow has nothing to bond to. That was a really dangerous year. That was the most dangerous year I've ever seen. And some of the guys that we backcountry with are, one of the guys is into his 70s, and he said he'd never seen it like that. So that year we played it safe. We skied really slight aspects. We skied only runs that were treed. If you think of trees in the snow, trees act as an anchor. So they stabilize the snow. And we had skinned up in this area called Powder Cache. And when we got to the top, we started down through the trees and saw that our uptrack had all slid in the trees. And that was kind of an unheard of event, and it really humbled us. That year, Glenn kicked off a slide, and fortunately, he wasn't in it. So when you're out there in the backcountry, you have to be self-reliant. We have probes, we have avalanche beacons, and we have shovels. And there's a protocol for skiing that you never take your eye off your buddy. You'll ski down for a little bit and then hide on the side of a slope or behind a tree. And then you wait and you kind of leapfrog down the mountain. And you have to trust those that you ski with because it's not something to be taken lightly. There are no ski patrollers out here bombing. There's no stabilizing. There's no, the runs aren't closed off when it's dangerous. It's up to you to educate yourself and to know what you're doing. Having said that, slides happen. So this year, we were in the North Cascades and we had met two of our friends up there. And we were skiing with a local friend of ours. And we'd skied for a couple days and we'd climbed, I want to say, about 5,000 feet. Now, early season, I didn't ski last year because of my hips. So early season, 5,000 feet is a pretty serious climb. So we went to this one bowl and it's a couple miles in. So you're not really climbing, but you're skinning in, and the gear is really fabulous. For those of you unfamiliar with backcountry ski gear, the skis and the boots, the bindings, instead of being fixed on your ski, there's a pin system and it attaches to your toe. And so the back of your heel is free, much like telemark skis. However, when you get to the top and you want to ski down, you twist the back binding and then it turns into this prong and it locks in your heel. So you can actually Nordic ski down, but you have free heels for climbing up. And the base of your ski, you have what's called a skin, and it looks like directional indoor-outdoor carpet, and it's poking that way. And you put that on your ski, and if you have wide powder skis, it's almost like you're a tractor. You can go up really steep stuff instead of sliding like you would if you didn't have a skin on. So you get to the top and you rip your skins, click your heels down, and then you just ski down normally. So we had hiked in and it was maybe an 8-hour day. The next morning I got up early and I had worn the skin off the front of my shins and my heels were blistered. My feet were just a total mess. And I had taken a knitting project that I was really close to finishing. And so I got up that morning and I was exhausted and I was sore and my feet, I just couldn't imagine putting them in ski boots that day. So I decided not to go. And my husband and three of our close friends were all buried in an avalanche. They were in an area called the Hairpin Turn. It's an area that we have skied many times. And there's a known slide path in that. It's a ravine, and there's a known slide path called Steroid Bowl. It's a cliff band at the top, and then there's a large bowl, and it kind of flattens out a little bit, and then there's another bowl. And it's clear when you're in there that it's an avalanche slide path. The top of the mountain where the cliffs are loads, meaning the wind coming from the north pushes snow up there and it creates these massive cornices. And the cornices break off and they fall and they trigger the bowl and the whole thing slides. We have skied around Steroid Bowl a couple different times where we're high on the mountain and we're skiing. And it's such a clearly dangerous place that we've gone down, around, and then back up. And this day, Glenn and Schwag and Birch and Shia It was the third run of the day. They had been in that ravine skiing, and they were relatively high, and their option was to cut across steroid bowl and ski down to the sleds, because from there they could make it without having to put their skins back on. Or they could ski down into the ravine and then around and then skin back up and then ski. Because it was late in the day, Enschweig and Birch were wanting to hit the road. So they just decided to ski steroid bowl. And they were at the top of the bowl when the avalanche hit them. Birch went the furthest. He was taken up for about 1,000 feet and he was buried. Schwag and Shia were somewhere in between. So what happened was they were all four at the top and Birch was ready to ski. Glenn still hadn't put his snowboard on and didn't have his backpack on, and Birch said, "Hey, do you guys mind if I start skiing?" And they said, "Yeah, no problem." And Birch took off down the mountain, and one of the guys yelled, and Sean yelled, "Run!" And Shia and Sean took off down the hill, and Glenn looked up and saw just like what he said was white smoke. The whole upper bowl was just this frothing powder field, and he knew it was an avalanche. He put his front leg in his binding and went to kick with the back leg like a skateboard move, and he knew that it was hopeless. So he kicked the snowboard off, turned, and watch the avalanche take him. He went about 150 feet, and the whole time he was swimming. So that is the technique. If you get in an avalanche, you are supposed to swim. And swim, and if you touch something solid, kick off like it's the bottom of the ocean. And he did that, and it stopped, and he realized that he was not buried. He was on the surface, and he took one really deep breath, and then the second avalanche hit him. And it took him about that far. Each ride was about 150 feet. And he has a GPS, he had his GPS on, and so it tracked the whole slide. Glenn took the shortest ride, so he was the highest up the mountain. And Shia was about 200 or 300 feet below him, and he shouted up, "Is anybody up there?" And Glenn said, "I am." And he says, "Where's Schwag?" And Schwag answered, he said, "I'm over here." So luckily the three boys were fairly close together. And then they said, "Go in receive mode." So the transponders we have search and receive. And so they all switched their transponders over to receive, and there was no signal. Mike was missing. And so they started to look. Glenn was going up the hill. The other boys were going down the hill. Schwag's arm was completely dislocated. So he wasn't a lot of help. He was in so much pain. Shia had broken his foot. He thought he had broken his foot. And so Glenn looks up and he sees something red in the snow, in the debris path, and he thought it was Mike. So he goes over to dig him out, and he realized it was his backpack. So now Glenn has his probe and he has his shovel. And all three of them are looking for Mike. Well, Schwag was a little bit out of commission because he was in so much pain with his shoulder. So they're heading down the mountain and nobody can find Mike. Now, Mike has a wife and two little kids. So all three guys think that he's buried. But the most frightening thing is Mike, they couldn't even pick up his signal. He was so far from them that the transponders wouldn't even locate him. And so about that time, they were all systematically heading down the mountain, and Mike shouted up. He had been buried and dug himself out, and he didn't have any physical injuries. His mouth was packed full of snow. He was vomiting up blood and snow, and his injuries were minor, but psychologically, he went 1,000 feet in that slide. So they all got back to the vehicles. There was one snow bike and 2 snowmobiles. Luckily, I had loaned my snowmobile to Schwag and Birch that morning, because they were towing up. And so Glenn was the only one that was able to ride the snow bike out, because Schwag couldn't ride it because of his shoulder. So Glenn rode his bike, and the snowmobiles, they got everybody sorted out and on the snowmobiles, and I was supposed to meet them at 4, and I had been in the parking lot, and it was now close to 8 o'clock. And I was out of service, and Glenn said, right before I dropped him off, he said, we're probably not going to make it back by 4. He goes, you'd be okay if you got here a little bit late. I know my husband well. This is a man that loves adventure, and he spends the night out going a little bit too big in the mountains, and he's fairly notorious for luring people out after dark. So I get there at 5. I'm not worried a speck until 6:30, and it gets dark about 6:37. And so I'm thinking, well, you know, maybe they went up to this really beautiful place called Rainy Lake, and it's, you know, a 12-mile, 10-mile snowmobile in, and maybe a slide went over the road and they can't get the sleds back out and they've got to dig out. There's all of these possible scenarios going through my head. And at about 7 o'clock, I knew that something was wrong. And it was 30 miles into town, about 20 miles, 15 miles into cell service. And I figured if I go into town and back, I'll be gone an hour. And if something is wrong and they get back and they need my help, I'm not going to be there. And there's no services out there. So I gave myself to 8 o'clock. And if they weren't back by 8, I was going to go in and mobilize a search and rescue party for the morning. So at 8 o'clock, I was sitting in the car, and I knew that I should stay for 5 more minutes. I couldn't leave. 5 more minutes, and then I'll go. And it was 8:04, and I saw a light in my rearview mirror. It was a snowmobile light. And so I knew it was them, and I get to them, and they said, we were all taken out in an avalanche. Shias broke his foot. Schwag might have broken his shoulder. Glenn was totally fine, and Birch was psychologically in shock. He was really shaken up. And so now, a month later, poor Schwig's shoulder is in really bad shape. We didn't know that it was dislocated. We didn't know if his collarbone was broken. We just didn't know what was wrong. And because we were so rurally, we were 2 hours from Wenatchee. Both Glenn and I offered to take him into the hospital. The rural clinic was closed, and he said no. So I put a thing out on Facebook, and we got somebody brought some pain meds that they had from a recent surgery. So he took a couple of those, and then they drove back to Hood River the following morning, and Mike drove him. Ashias was in a orthopedic boot for, I think, 6 weeks. And it was, Glenn and I stayed. We ended up staying for another week and a half. But the next day, we didn't ski at all. We just hung out in the hotel room. And then the following day, we did an extreme cross-country ski. And then the third day, we went back up in the mountains. And we continued our skiing trip. Definitely humbled. Definitely more aware. Definitely with more respect. And I've put together little bits of the event and the week. So I'll show you some ski footage of the area. This was the avalanche forecast. This was on their front page after Glenn and the boys went for a ride. And the following day, a seasoned veteran ski patroller, I think he's in his early 50s, was actually buried in an avalanche, and he was dug out by his clients. He was a heli guide. Life-lighted and survived. The next day, a group of three kicked off a slide that buried three people below them, a different party. And so avalanches that week, it was highly unpredictable. There was wind loading, there were cornices, there was just a lot of events. The slide that took the boys out was from a cornice breaking off. Above that rocky cliff band, a cornice, a wind-loaded snow, icy chunk, broke off, landed in the bowl above them, and that is what actually hit them. Had the snow not been well bonded and had it not been really stable, the cornice would have triggered that entire bowl to unleash, and my husband and three friends would be buried under 10 feet of snow had that happened. So the probability of the avalanche happening was low, but the consequences were high. And they just happened to be at the wrong place at the wrong time. Miraculously, they're all okay. And they're going to make full recoveries and they're alive. But at the time I just couldn't physically make the video, but it was it's a real thing. For those of you that are skiers, for those of you that love to play in the backcountry, be very careful and never put yourself in a situation where a slide could happen, right? So a lot of us are skiing open bowls because that's pure joy. And that's kind of what we seek out. But know the conditions, follow it, not just that week, but throughout the course of the year. Because you should really know what each of those storm systems look like as they come in over the course of the season. And dig pits, take all of the precautions that you know, and then some. There's a saying, there's old backcountry skiers, and there are bold backcountry skiers, but there are no old, bold backcountry skiers. So, yeah, scary. Hug your loved ones. Live big. Don't be afraid. Be safe. See you in the next video.